through my career up until I got to the big leagues, I'd always been told, always look for the fastball, and that's what I did. And in the minor leagues, pitchers missed with their curves and all, and they had to, always got some fastballs to hit in the minor leagues. And so Joe asked me, he said, Eddie, don't you ever guess for pitches? And I'd always been told, don't guess. I tried it one time in the Eastern League and it didn't work. But I didn't know how to, you can guess, but it seemed like I guessed wrong all the time in the minor leagues. But I stopped it and I said, no, I don't. And he said, well, one of these days you're gonna find out that the best balls you hit are gonna be balls you're looking for, that you're guessing for. And so the next day we were going to Tucson to play, and I got my seat next to Rogers Hornsby, and I wanted to ask him that question. And I did. I got talking about hitting, and I asked him, should I guess for pitches? And he said, hell no, hit what you see. And that, one of the greatest hitters of all time telling me that, was, I listened to him other than Gordon. And so I wound up hitting 254 and whatever I hit in 48. Anyway, and when I was traded, got to Washington, and we were in Boston, they had a rain out. And we were sitting around, we had to wait. And then finally they called the game, the players drifted out, and there were only three people left in the clubhouse, the manager, Joe Kuehl, Clyde Mylan, a coach, and me. And we got talking about hitting, and they asked me, didn't I ever look for pitches? I said, no, I've been told not to ever guess. They said, it's not guessing. And I said, what do you mean it's not guessing? They said, well, you look for a certain pitch. If it's not that pitch, you don't hit at it. And that made all the sense in the world to me. And they said, they used Joe Dobson as an example. They said, he's a curveball pitcher. If you're up hitting at him with men on base, he knows you're a fastball hitter. What do you think he's going to throw you? And I said, well, a curveball. They said, well, don't you think you have a better hit chance of hitting it if it is, if you're looking for it? I said, yeah. They said, well, then that's what you do. And if it's a fastball, you don't hit at it. That's the key. You don't hit it, the pitch you're not looking for. And at that time, I was hitting around 220. And it was, you know, it was early May. The season had been going about 3 or 4 weeks. And I wound up making the All-Star team, hitting about 320. That's the difference it made with me. So I say that I didn't know how to hit when I was in Cleveland. Because when you're in the minors, you get those fastballs to hit. And the guys can't get their breaking stuff over, but when you get to the big leagues, they can get the curveball over. So they were getting me out. They would show me a fastball and then throw a sloppy curve, and I'd play pepper with the second baseman.
I want to just briefly introduce Eddie and tell you a little bit about our collaboration, and then I know you're here to hear Eddie and from not me. But as Tom said, I love baseball history, and I love history generally, and I love baseball, and so I love baseball history, and I particularly like what we call the oral tradition of baseball, which is the stories that come from, if you think about it, 25 young men spending 6 to 7 months together, and in Eddie's time on trains and rooming together and playing 154 plus games, there are a lot of stories that occur, and a lot of funny things and a lot of meaningful things both on and off the field. And so if somebody doesn't write that stuff down when legends like Eddie are no longer with us, then they're gone. And so that's really my motivation. And I was really drawn to Eddie's story because it's really unique in a couple of respects. He, as Tom said, was in professional baseball for 65 years, and there aren't many that can top that. In fact, he spent his entire career in baseball, and Eddie, one of my favorite lines about Eddie is, you can see he's 92 years old, and he's still playing golf several times a week, and Robin Roberts once said about Eddie, you know why he looks so good? He never had a real job. Maybe there's something to that. He's also the rare individual who had a very successful career as a player and then in the front office as a baseball executive. You just can't name many people that excelled both as a player and as a general manager. He played 13 years in the big leagues for 7 different teams, and then later worked for 7 more teams. And of course, he was the general manager for 7 or 8 years of the Atlanta Braves before coming over for about 5 years with the Texas Rangers. And he was not a run-of-the-mill big league ball player. He made 4 All-Star teams, played in 2 World Series, held the Chicago White Sox team home run record for I think about 30 years, and I'll get him to tell you he's one of the few players to ever hit a ball out of Old Comiskey Park all the way out, and I'll let him tell you who the other was it five other five
a bunch
yeah four well it wasn't that many four or five so and not only that, in his baseball career, he rubbed elbows and knew and was friends with the likes of Tris Speaker, Hank Greenberg, Babe Ruth, Dizzy Dean, Jackie Robinson, Joe DiMaggio, Bill Veeck. He was teammates with Bob Feller, Satchel Paige, Mickey Mantle, Yogi Berra, Whitey Ford, Brooks Robinson. The list goes on and on. So it's living history. Eddie is living history. But more than his baseball career, I was drawn to Eddie's story because it's really an amazing American success story. He grew up in Paris, Texas, in a largely single family, single parent house during the height of the Depression. And as Tom mentioned, he served for almost 4 years in World War II, and is a card-carrying member of America's greatest generation. His career in the Navy was the prime of his baseball career, and it almost cost him his baseball career, and I hope he'll tell you that story. He was very, very fortunate not to be able to play baseball again after he got out of the service. And then he played very, very well. His first full year was in 47 with the Cleveland Indians, and then he was with the 48 Cleveland Indians, and they won the World Series, and guess what? They haven't won it since. He was a good enough player. Talk about high praised. Ted Williams frequently said about Eddie, I've heard this and read it, that Eddie Robinson was the greatest clutch hitter he ever played against. So that's pretty high praise for a ball player. So without further ado, I'm going to turn this over to Eddie and ask him to tell you some story. And my role here is to prompt him if I think he's missing something. So Eddie, take it away.
I love Paul's introduction because he never leaves anything out. He says everything I told him to say. Paul and I've had a very good relationship, and I'm surprised no one yet has mentioned the book we wrote. Yeah. Paul and I co-authored a book called Lucky Me. And it's my history starting out in Paris, Texas, and ending up with the Texas Rangers. I'm not a speech maker. I'm a storyteller more than anything else. And if you can, you can take yourself back with me to Paris, Texas, in 1938, 37, during the Depression. And we didn't have high school baseball. We just, as kids, we played the game. And I happened to have a friend whose father was interested in kids baseball, and he formed a team called Charlie Osborne was his name. They were called Charlie Osborne's Cubs. And we played on Sundays. We worked out during the week. We didn't have money to buy bases. We'd use cow pads for second base, first base. You slide into them, they kick away, you bring them back, put them in place. Then we'd play with a ball until the cover wore out, and we'd tape it up and play with it. We'd break a bat, we'd nail it together, and take up a collection on Sunday to buy balls to play the next Sunday with. I'm regressing with you because it was an important, really important part of my life, getting started in baseball. I knew I was pretty good. I knew I was a pretty good hitter, but I never thought that I'd get a chance to play professionally. But luckily, a scout came through Paris and saw me play, and he was a scout for Knoxville, Tennessee. And in those days, minor league teams were mostly independent. They didn't have agreements with major league teams like they do today. So he signed me. I had a chance to go to the University of Texas on a scholarship, but being depression the way it was, and just my mother and I, he offered me a $300 bonus and a contract for $150 a month. And I said, you know, in 4 years I could be in the big leagues if I'm any good. In 4 years I'd be finishing school. So I know I want to be a ball player. So she and I decided that I should play, and I did. I signed. And I left Paris. My uncle Lewis was quite a successful man. He started the first motor freight line in East Texas, probably in Texas, called Northeast Texas Motor Freight Line. Well, I worked for him while I was going to high school. And when I was getting ready to leave, and I made $6 a week.
And for Eddie, tell him your day you're in high school.
My what?
Your day.
Oh, yeah. I was getting to that. I would get up at 5 o'clock in the morning, and I paid a taxi to come, and he would wake me up. He'd honk his horn. I'd jump up and put my clothes on, and I'd go to work. The taxi cost me 10 cents a day to get to work, and I'd work till 8 o'clock. This was during the week. And then I'd go to school, and when we got out of school, I played all the sports. So then we had sports every afternoon until late, and then I had a date every night, so I had a pretty full day. I had a pretty full day. Anyway, I got ready to leave Paris, and I had a bus ticket to Valdosta, Georgia. And Valdosta is southern Georgia, a long way from Texas. My Uncle Lewis said, how much money you got? I said, $6. Well, $6, and it was a month of spring training and the season, before the season started. He said, well, that ought to be enough. He said, they pay your expenses, don't they? I said, yeah. Oh, he said, good luck. So I took off and got to Valdosta, and I thought I was a pretty good player. Everybody said, from Paris, they all said, oh, you'll kill them in that Class D league, Valdosta, which was the lowest. Class D was the lowest you can get in professional baseball. Well, sure enough, I went to Valdosta. I ran out of money. I had to pawn my watch to eat until we got paid the first 15 days. You don't get paid for 15 days of the season. Anyway, I made it through that. I got a terrible start. It was pitiful. After about a month of the season, I was not hitting 200. And I was afraid I was going to get sent home, which would have been real disaster. You know, these kids leave home with thinking they're stars, and then they have to come home defeated. That's a sad thing. Anyway, after a month of the season had passed, we were in Albany, Georgia, one morning. That's one of the towns we stayed overnight. And I was having breakfast and got up to leave, and the manager was sitting over there. And I was trying to steer clear of him. I didn't want him to, I didn't want to see him any more than I had to. And he called me over. He said, "Come here, Robbie." They called me Robbie in those days. And he said, "I got to tell you, we got another first baseman coming in." Well, my heart sank. And because I thought he was going to say, "We got to release you." But he fooled me. He said, "But we're not going to release you." And then my heart, I got to breathing again. And he said, I said, "Well, I'm proud that you're not releasing me. I'm happy." I said, "I know I can hit better than I'm hitting." He said, "Eddie, it's not, Robbie, it's not your hitting that's bothering us, it's your fielding." So you can imagine, I thought I was a pretty good fielder. He said, "You got to learn to catch pickups. Infielders in those days were wild and they threw a lot of balls in the dirt." And he said, "You got to learn to do that." And so the next day, my roommate and I got out and put the batting cage behind first base so I wouldn't have to chase the ones that I missed. And he threw me balls until I got very proficient at catching them. And I got really good at it. But the next game I got in, I was in the outfield. And they moved me back to first base. I got a couple hits. And they let the other first baseman go. So I finished up the season, I think I hit 250, 249. But I was improving toward the end of the year. But we had another meeting, we're in Albany again, we had a meeting, team meeting, and the manager critiqued each player. And he came to me, he said, "Robinson, you may as well go back to Paris, Texas and open up an ice cream parlor. You're never gonna get to the big leagues." Now that's what my manager told me. So I came back to Paris, and I didn't open an ice cream parlor. But the next year, I went back to the same team, same manager, made the All-Star team, hit 324, hit 21 triples, drove in 100 runs, and I was on my way. Next stop was, am I boring you with all this? Am I too far back for you? This is what it was like in the 40s. To be a baseball player. I got to Elmira, New York was my next stop. And I had a pretty good year, hit 295. It was a big ballpark. I only hit four home runs. And we won the championship. And in winning the championship, we went into the playoffs and we played Wilkes-Barre, who had won the pennant. And they had a pitcher named Red Embry who had won 22, 23 games. And he had a curveball and he was almost unhittable. So we decided that our manager decided he'd pitch our poorest starting pitcher against their best. So we would still have our good pitchers left after we got rid of Embry. Figured we were going to lose to him. What do you think happened? Our pitcher was named Clarence Pickerel. And Clarence and Red matched zeros for nine innings. And Embry hadn't allowed a hit. We didn't have a hit, but the score was nothing to nothing. And Pickerel's still pitching. So we go into the 10th inning, and Jess Pike hits a home run, and we win. We beat Embry, 1-0, and swept the series after that, and went on and won the championship, the Governor's Cup. And for that, we got $60 apiece. And with my $60, I bought a Hartman trunk. Now, we used to travel by train all the time, never flew anywhere. And a Hartman trunk was a fancy trunk that it opened up and you could hang clothes in it, you know. And, And I had a great desire to have one. So that's what I did with my $60. I bought a Hartman trunk. My next stop was Baltimore, Maryland, and I had a good year. I hit 24 home runs, and my power kind of blossomed. I hit 300. But Cleveland and Baltimore had a working agreement that Baltimore was independent, and they owned all their players. But for Cleveland to send their prospects to Baltimore, they had the option of buying any two players that Baltimore owned for $10,000 each. And so at the end of the season, I was one of the 10 players. I was one of the two players that they paid $10,000 for. So I went to Cleveland and finished the year, and then went in the Navy for over 3 years. I went into the Navy in 1942. In 1943 and 1944, I was at the Norfolk Naval Training Station, and they had a team. The training station had a team, and the Naval Air Station, which was adjoining to the training station, had a team. And then we played 4 or 5 times a week, and we drew good crowds. It was entertainment for the soldiers, for the sailors who were there in training. And I was on the team with a bunch of big leaguers. DiMaggio, Dominic was on the team, Freddie Hutchinson, Benny McCoy, Tommy Byrne, Jeff Cross, Charlie Wagner, who played for the pitcher for the Red Sox. They were on my team. And the air station had a team, and Pee Wee Reese was on that team. Rizzuto was on our shortstop, and Pee Wee was their shortstop. Hugh Casey, Herman Franks, they had a number of major league team players on their team, and we used to play each other quite a bit. And we had a Navy World Series at the end of each season, and we beat them. So, and then I was shipped from there to Hawaii in 1944. At the end of the 1944 season, with a whole bunch of baseball players, and we were in Hawaii for a while, and then they were dispersed down into the islands to set up athletic programs in the islands. The thing I remember that always comes to my mind is that the captain of the Naval Training Station, Captain McClure, was a great baseball fan. And so he arranged to watch all the games sitting in the dugout. And in the summer, of course, he would be wearing his white uniform, and he had white sheets put on the benches in the dugout. So he's sitting there one day, and they would pull his car right up next to the dugout, and he would get out of his car and sit in the dugout. So Dominic DiMaggio and Freddie Hutchinson ran into each other in the outfield one day, and they're both on the ground, looked like they were hurt badly. So the captain jumps up and gets in his car, and his driver drives him out to center field to see how they are. And fortunately, DiMaggio's glasses had cut him, but they were just shook up, and they were okay. While in the Navy, I had a bone tumor on my leg, and they operated on it, and they paralyzed my leg. And looked like my career was over. But the doctor said there's one person in the Navy that can fix your leg, and he's at Bethesda Naval Hospital, Captain Gray, head of neurosurgery at Bethesda Naval Hospital. Don't let anybody else touch you till you get there. Well, I told they wanted to operate on me in Oakland, California. I said, no, I got to go to Bethesda, closer to home. I was living in Baltimore. So they they transferred me. They said they don't have any beds at that hospital in Bethesda. And so they sent me to Quantico, Virginia, which was the closest thing they had to a nerve doctor was a psychologist. And he said, we're going to discharge you. I said, no, I got to go to Bethesda. He said, you can't. Well, Dr. George Bennett, who I knew well from playing in Baltimore, had operated on Joe DiMaggio. Joe DiMaggio at one time had an Achilles heel. And Bennett had such a fine reputation as an orthopedic doctor that he's the guy that operated on DiMaggio. And he was a good friend of mine. So I called him up. And I said, they want to get rid of me and I want to go to Bethesda. He said, just stand there by that payphone. Give me the number. I gave him the number. And he called me back in 10 minutes. He said, they'll be down to get you tomorrow in a station wagon and take you to Bethesda. He happened to be a good friend of Captain Gray, the guy that I wanted to see. So he arranged it, and I went, and they operated on my leg. I had what you call foot drop. I couldn't pick my toe up like that. And today I wear a brace because of it. But they operated on me, and then they discharged me, and Dr. Bennett sort of treated me and gave me therapy. And they said a nerve grows an inch a month. And I was operated on in June. And they said, by spring training, if you're going to be able to play baseball, you'll begin to not need that brace anymore. And sure enough, the opening day of spring training in Clearwater, Florida, I threw the brace away. And I played my whole career. And no one ever knew. I had what they classified as 90% recovery. And threw the brace away, played my whole career. As soon as I stopped playing, my foot went back down like that. And I've had that foot drop ever since. The doctors who operated on me, Captain Gray and his associate, said, we can't figure that out, and we'd like to operate on you and see what's wrong. They said, it won't cost you a penny. Just let us do it to see why it happened. They were practicing in Bethesda and Pasadena, California. So I went out there, and they operated on me, and it didn't cost me anything. But, you know, they went in there, and they couldn't find any reason at all that I should get the foot drop again. There wasn't anything wrong. So I figured the good Lord just wanted me to play baseball. And I'm very thankful for that. And I've lived with this foot drop now ever since I retired. It got a little progressively worse. 5 years after I retired, it happened. But after that, I wanted to stay in baseball. And Paul Richards, who I played for in the big leagues, and he's the best manager I ever had, smartest baseball man I ever knew. Lived in Waxahachie, Texas. He's a good Texan. And I played for him in Chicago. And then when I was finally released my last year in the big leagues, he signed me on as a coach. And he knew I wanted to be in the front office. I didn't have any desire to manage or be a coach. And so he gave me a job with Baltimore. And then he moved to Houston, and I went down there with him. And I'm skipping a very important thing, the World Series in Cleveland. I had a good big league career, but I guess two highlights of my career were, first of all, winning the World Championship with the Indians in 1948, and then playing for the New York Yankees and Mickey Mantle and Yogi and all those guys in New York for 3 years. That was a wonderful thing. But I'll tell you a little bit about 1948. We didn't have any 1947. We just had a mediocre team. But we had traded for Joe Gordon, who was a huge part of our success. And we started out the season in 1948. We won the first four ball games, bingo. And Joe and I were roommates. And we're getting in a cab, I'll never forget, in St. Louis. And Joe said, we're going to win the pennant. And I thought he was crazy. But from that time on, we were in the race. And it wasn't any ordinary pennant race. It was one of those tight, tight races where there are four teams that have a chance to win: Philadelphia, New York, Boston, and Cleveland. And all year long, we were in and out of first place. And then got down near the end of the season, and Philadelphia had dropped out, but Boston, New York, and Cleveland were right there. And we came down to the last game of the season, and Hal Newhouser is pitching for, they're playing Detroit. Hal Newhouser is pitching for them. I forget who pitched for us. But if we win that game, we win the pennant. If we lose, well then, if Boston beats New York, and they're Boston and New York are right there, depending on who wins that game, if we lose, then there's going to be a playoff. So that's what happened. Boston beat New York, and we lost to Detroit, and so we're in a tie. After 154 games, it's tied. We had lost the toss, and so we had to go. We couldn't play at home. We had to go on the road if it was a tie. So we had to get on the train that night after losing on a Sunday. We got on the train Sunday night and rode all night long to Boston and played the next day. And we had a left-hand pitcher, Gene Bearden, who had never been a very successful major league pitcher until that year. And he got a trick pitch of some kind. He was great. He won over 20 games. He's one of the big reasons we won the pennant and the World Series. But we had a meeting before the game, and Boudreaux says, well, he said, there hasn't been a left-hander start and finish a game in Boston all year. And he said, our best pitcher so far down the stretch has been Bearden. So he said, we're going to start Bearden. Well, Bearden started and won the game. So we won the game 8-3. And then Boston Braves had the Boston, were the Bees, I guess. They were Braves.
No, they were the Braves.
They were the Braves. Boston Braves won the National League. And we just stayed in Boston and played them. And believe me, many, many games, I don't know how many, but we'd have 80,000 people at a ball game in Cleveland because we were playing in that big municipal stadium. And you wonder what it's like to play baseball in front of 80,000 people. I'd rather play in front of 80,000 than 2,500. Because you can hear those 2,500 yelling at you. They can be giving you a bad time and you can hear them. But with 80,000 people, and all you hear is a kind of a constant roar. Anyway, we won. And there's so many, every guy on, going to Boston that night before the playoff game, our guys were pretty loose, and we had a couple of guys who were pretty good drinkers. One of them, we had to put to bed. We had to take his pants off and put him in the berth on the train. And next day, he hit two home runs. And talking about train riding, we always rode train. And if you were a regular or a pitcher who was going to pitch the next day, they put you on the middle. In the middle of the train. If you're an irregular or weren't going to pitch, they put you over the wheels. You don't have as good a ride over the wheels as you have in the middle of the train. I'll go back now to Paul Richards, and And I stayed with Paul, went to Kansas City. I worked for Charlie Finley, and that was an experience. And then I, Paul got a job in Atlanta, and I went over there and worked for him in Atlanta. And then they let Paul go, and they named me the general manager. And for 6 years, I was there. I was there when Ted Turner bought the team. And Ted was, at that time, not a rich man. He did own a television station, and he saw he was interested in the satellite, and he saw the future. He was a very forward-thinking guy. He saw the future of television and with his radio station, and so he bought the Rangers, and I think he only paid $10 million for the Braves, I'm talking about. And he bought them, and he and I had a little problem in the beginning, but in the end, we were good friends. He's a really nice guy. He's a man's man. He loves competition, and he won the America's Cup, you know, the sailing race. He won that twice, which is a very, very big accomplishment. But anyway, I'll tell you a little story. He didn't want me to come to Texas when I told him that I was going to, that I'd been offered the job in Texas. He said, let me tell you, he said, don't say yes for a week. Wait a week before you say yes. And I said, okay. He said, let me tell you why. He said, when I was growing up and I was in high school going into college, I was in love with a girl. And he said, really in love, and she threw me over for another guy. And he said, I was so upset and disturbed that I figured, he said, you know, my grandfather killed himself and my father committed suicide. So he said, I thought I'd just commit suicide. So he said, I rented a room in the top floor of the tallest hotel in Nashville, Tennessee. And I went up there and I was going to jump out the window. And I got up in the window and I'm ready to jump. And I told myself, you know, Ted, you don't have to do this today. You can do it tomorrow. So he said, I got down out of the window. And he said, I went back up there the next day and did the same thing. And I told myself the same thing, got back down out of the window. And he said, I went up there the third day and then I realized I didn't have to do that at all. So he said, I think if you, this was, he says, I think if you'll wait a week before you decide to go to Texas, you won't go at all. You'll stay here with me. And he offered me a 5-year contract. And another funny thing, as I say, he didn't have much money when he bought the team. So we parked in the tunnel underneath the stadium. The office staff and the executives parked. And they had their name on the wall. Well, I had the club was furnishing me with a Cadillac, and I was parked. And when Ted came on, they put him behind me, and he was driving a Toyota. He didn't like that a bit. But he told me when he was trying to get me, he said, you can even keep that Cadillac. He said, I'll give you a 5-year contract if you keep the Cadillac. Now, that's about the... then I came to Texas. Brad Corbett was a great guy. And he and Bobby Brown, how many of you saw Bobby Brown last year? He's a great guy, Bobby. And Brad got me over here, and now this is a funny story. Brad is introducing me at the ballpark. We're having a introduction party. He's gonna introduce me to all the partners in the ball club. He had a bunch of partners, minor partners, but they and their wives were there, and we'd had dinner, and Brad's getting up to introduce me. Well, Brad and I both smoked cigars, and we each had a cigar in our hand. So he's introducing me, and then he said, Eddie, won't you say a few words? I got up, I took one last puff off that cigar, and it exploded. You've seen those, I don't know if you, but the kid used to load cigars, and when a guy would the fire, it would explode, and suddenly you got a big ball of tobacco right on, And that happened to me. Now, my kids had loaded that cigar before I left Atlanta. And I just happened to have that cigar at that time. That was one of life's embarrassing moments. But I know Paul's just dying for me to tell you a Yankee story. And I have a favorite Yogi story, which is when I was with the Yankees, Yogi and his wife Carmen and Betty and I became very good friends, and we palled around together. This one day, we had played a night game, and then we had a Sunday doubleheader, and I decided that I didn't want to take batting practice. So I didn't get to the park until late, and the players were out taking hitting practice when I got there. So when the hitting practice was over, I was getting my uniform on, and as they came in from the field, Yogi, as soon as he walked through the door, he walked right over to my locker, and he said, "Where were you today?" And I said, "Well, I didn't want to take batting practice, and so I got here late." He said, "Well, you really missed it." And I said, "What did I miss?" He said, "There were two streakers." He said, "They jumped on the field at the right field foul pole, and they ran all the way across the field to the left field foul pole, jumped in the stands and ran off." He said, "And they didn't have any clothes on." I said, "No kidding. What were they, boys or girls?" He thought for a minute. "I don't know. They had bags on their heads." I don't. Did Bobby tell him the story about coaching Yogi for his day?
I don't think
well,
so.
Yogi's from St. Louis, and I wasn't with the team at this time, but Bobby Brown was. Now, Bobby was educated, and Yogi thought he just was a big man. So he said, "Bobby, I wish you'd help me with my speech." He said, I never had to talk to a bunch of people.
They're giving him a day in St. Louis, in his hometown. They're honoring him before the game.
Yeah, they were honoring Yogi. It was Yogi Berra Day, and he was going to have to make some sort of an acceptance speech. So Bobby coached him for about a week on what he should say. And so the Yogi gets up, they hand him a mic. He said, "I'd like to thank all you people for making this night necessary." Yogi was, he was a funny guy. Is there a story I've forgotten that you want me to tell?
Well, you can tell the Marilyn Monroe story.
Yeah, I'll tell you the Marilyn Monroe story. You all know who Marilyn Monroe is? Marilyn Monroe, we were in training with the White Sox in Pasadena, California. And we got to the ballpark one day, and this real pretty girl showed up. She had shorts on, short shorts, and a tight jersey, and not much else. And so she was there for a photo shoot, and they were going to use our outfielder, Gus Zernial, who was a big, handsome guy. He stayed with her all day, and they did all kind of publicity shots to promote her career. This was early in, I'm talking about 1952, which was early in Marilyn Monroe's career. So we all, when we could, we all took a peek at what was happening, and we watched her all day, and then that was the end of it. About 3 days later, everybody on the team received an autographed picture from Marilyn Monroe. And my autographed picture said, "With love to Eddie, Marilyn Monroe," which was great, except she spelled Eddie, E-D-I. And I thought, anybody can't spell Eddie better than E-D-I. I don't want their, and I tore it up. I just read where some guy sold a signed Marilyn Monroe picture for $75,000. Another, are you tired of listening to me? Yeah. Another interesting story sad for me, but interesting for you. When Babe Ruth, they were going to retire Babe Ruth's number in Yankee Stadium, and he was coming there for the ceremony. And at one time, the Yankee clubhouse was back of the third base dugout in Yankee Stadium. And then they changed it, and they moved it back of first base, and the third base clubhouse became the visiting clubhouse. Well, they didn't move the lockers. And Babe Ruth's locker was always in the visiting clubhouse. It was locked up, but it remained there. And when he came there for his last time in Yankee Stadium, he wanted to get dressed in his old locker, so he had to come into the visiting clubhouse to get his uniform on. Well, he was a very sick man. He only lived about 4 months from the time I'm talking about. He had throat cancer, and he was sick. He got his uniform on, he came out onto our bench, and he had his private physician with him. But he sat there and talked to us for a while in a very raspy kind of voice. And so now it came time for the ceremony. And he gets up to go up to home plate. And I don't know why I did it, but I thought he needs some support. So I just reached in the bat rack, pulled out a bat, and handed it to him. And he walked up to home plate. They had the ceremony. And that's the bat he's holding, that famous shot from behind him when he's facing center field and he's got a bat in his hand. That's the bat. So he came back after the ceremony, and I got the bat and asked him, that makes a noise. I got the bat and asked him to autograph it, and he did. And I kept that bat for 30 years or more. At that time, memorabilia wasn't worth much. People didn't think about memorabilia. And then it began to get a little valuable, and one of the owners of the Yankees, Barry Helper, who was a collector of Ruth memorabilia, and he knew I had that bat, and he always said, Eddie, if you ever want to sell it, let me know. I'd like to buy it. So I told Betty one day, my wife, I said, you know, I don't know what that bat's worth, but I know it's not worth $10,000. I'm going to call Halper and tell him that I'm thinking about selling it and see what he'll offer me for it. So I did. And I told him, I said, Barry, I'm thinking about selling that bat. He said, how much you want for it? I said, $10,000. He said, I'll have the money to you tomorrow. There went the bat. Last time it sold, I think, for $112,000. Now, that's not the end of the story, though. There's one other story. Am I going too long?
No.
One other story about a Mickey Mantle ball. No one ever hit a ball out of Yankee Stadium, all the way out. But Mickey hit this ball off Pedro Ramos one night, and it hit about that far from the top of the facade around Yankee Stadium and bounded back onto the field. Well, they retrieved the ball, and after the game, they gave it to Mickey. And at the time, I had a restaurant in Baltimore, Maryland, and I had some sports things in there. The Babe Ruth bat was in there and some other things. And after the game, and they gave him the ball, he yelled across the clubhouse, hey, Eddie, how'd you like to have this ball for your restaurant? I said, great. So he signed it, tossed it to me, and I kept it for 20 years. And then I thought, I'm going to put it up for auction. Well, I put it up with a $15,000 retainer, meaning that if I didn't get $15,000, I wouldn't sell it. Well, it was the only thing, it was a bid up to $8,000. So I got the ball back. About 5 or 6 years later, in the meantime, I got an affidavit from Mickey. He signed it, that was the ball, and Bill Skarin and Hank Bauer witnessed his autograph. And then I got a picture of him that showed a dotted line up where it hit and coming down. And they put that in the magazine before the auction. See, and I had a bunch of other stuff in the auction because I'm a collector and I've collected a lot of stuff over the years. And the day of the auction, I played golf, so I didn't know the outcome. The next day, I called the guy and I said, well, how'd the auction go? He said, oh, it went pretty good. I said, you really got lucky on that mantle ball. And I said, well, what do you mean? He said, well, it sold for $42,000. So that helped make up a little bit for the Babe Ruth bat. I've talked a long time. I'll tell you what, if there's no time frame, and I'll be happy to answer a couple of questions. Anybody has a
question I have has to do with the first year when you joined the Rangers in 1977. The illustrious history of having four field managers in 1 year. And in fact, you had one manager that lasted 1 day. So could you talk a little bit about what happened with Frank Lucchese on your first spring training with the Rangers, and then Eddie the Brat Stanky, and what happened there? I think some folks might want to hear that. Thank you.
That's a good question and a very unusual happening. The Brad Corbett and the other owners, they weren't very happy with Lucchese, even though Lucchese was doing a pretty good job. We were playing 500 ball. But Brad was a hands-on owner, and he liked to have a decision and say in what was going on. And they were more or less insisting that we get another manager. And so they asked me to make a list of 10 people that I thought we could consider, and then we would discuss it. So I made a list, and I had 9 guys on the list, and I was trying to think of a 10th guy, and Stanky came to my mind, and I put him down as 10. And when we discussed the list, Stanky moved to the top, and Billy Hunter was my guy. I made my list at Hunter number 1. So they all Stanky, boy, that lit them up. And they said, let's get in touch with him, see if he'd be interested. Well, at that time, the operator, the stadium operator for the ballpark, set out. She wasn't enclosed. And if you happened to be walking by, you could hear what she was saying or who she was calling as you went into the offices. So I asked her if she would try to find Eddie Stanky and get him on the phone. And as she was trying to get him, Jim Reeves, who wrote for the Fort Worth Star-Telegram, happened to be walking by. And right away, he knew that we were thinking about changing managers. It wasn't 10 minutes till he was knocking on the private box door saying, are you going to hire Stanky as your manager? Well, that put us in a bad position. We hadn't even talked to Stanky yet. And Lucchese then, it was in the papers the next day. And poor old Frank, he had a bad time with it. We went down there and talked to Stanky, and he wanted the job. He wanted it very bad. And he even had a couple of his friends call me and say, hey, Stanky really wants that job. So we hired Stanky. But Stanky said, I can't be there. We hired him like on a Sunday. He said, I can't be there till Thursday. I got to do this and that. Well, all the time the papers they're hot on it. Anyway, came Thursday. The team is in Minnesota. And I flew up there, and Stanky flew in, and I had to tell Frank. He already knew he was gone. I had to tell him. And Frank Lucchese is a wonderful little guy. Anyway, Stanky met the press. He was very impressive and very happy. So we went out that night. We won the ball game, and coming back from the game, they were riding in the team bus, and he was talking to the coaches about what we're going to do the next day. So the next morning, at 8 o'clock, my phone rang. And I thought it was, and it was stanky. And I thought he wanted to have breakfast. I said, "Hey, Eddie, let's go have breakfast." He said, "No." He said, "Eddie, he says, I got to tell you, I can't take the job." Those were his exact words. "I can't take the job." And I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Well, I'm leaving. I'm not going to be a manager or your manager." He said, "I'm at the airport. I'm on a payphone right next to that plane I'm taking back home." He said, "I'm homesick." And I said, "Well, good luck." And he got on the plane and went home. There I am, manager for a day. And at that time, I should have become the manager. That's the one regret I have. I never managed a big league team, and that would have been my shot. All I had to say was, "I'm managing the team." But we had Connie Ryan, who had been a major league manager and was a good friend, and so I made him interim manager. And that soon as Stanky hung up talking to me, it wasn't fine. The phone rang again, and I picked it up, and I knew it was Yogi. And he said, "Hey, Eddie." And I said, "Yogi, what are you calling me for?" And he said, "Who is this?" I said, "This is Eddie Robinson." "Oh," he said, "I was calling Eddie Stanky to congratulate him on getting the job." I said, "Yogi, you won't believe this, but Eddie Stanky just quit. He went home. He said, 'You're shitting me.'" I said, "No." I said, "Do you want the job, Yogi?" "Oh, no." "I don't want that job. I don't want to be a manager." But that's the Eddie Stanky story, as verbatim. That's just how it happened.
Eddie, I would imagine you've got some Satchel Paige stories in your memory bank there.
Thank you. I don't have many Satch stories. He was, I can tell you about him. He was a rather quiet individual, and he couldn't throw it as hard as he did at one time when he was with us. But he could get the ball over the plate, and he had pinpoint control, and he pitched very well for us. One thing about him, he used to get gas on his stomach, and it was very painful to him. And we're playing in Washington one night, but if he took gas pills, he was okay. But this night he didn't take a gas pill, and he's pitching, and it's about the fifth inning, and he begins to get these gas pains in his stomach. So the manager went out and he said, "I forgot to take my gas pill." He said, "I really need them." And Boudreaux said, "Well, where are they?" And he said, "Well, they're in my locker." So Bob Lemon went in and found the pills, and he brought two pills out to Satch. And Satch, then a glass of water. And Satch said, "I'm only supposed to take one of these pills." And Lemon said, "Well, take two, they'll do you twice as much good." So he took the two pills, shut them out the rest of the way, and we won the ball game. But he used to tell me, we'd be autographing baseball, he'd say, "Eddie, I'm not going to sign my name under yours. You write too pretty." And another famous saying of his was, "Don't look behind you. Somebody might be gaining on you." You think about that a little bit. Don't ever look behind you. Somebody might be gaining on you. I like that quote.
If I could interject, I've got a good Satchel Paige story that Robin Roberts told me. When Roberts batted against Satchel in an exhibition game in the early 50s in Los Angeles, and Roberts, Satch had this big Ephus pitch that he'd throw sometimes, and Roberts timed it and got a base hit up the middle. And so years later, they're at the Hall of Fame when Satchel's getting inducted, and Roberts tells Satchel, "Hey, Satch, remember that base hit I got off you in Los Angeles?" And Satchel said, Roberts, I got a black book with all the good hitters in it that I've faced, and you ain't in it.
Mr. Robinson?
Another question?
Yeah, I'd like to ask you, as a player and as a general manager, you literally work both sides of the desk. As a general manager, I'm sure you probably have to work with sports agents negotiating salaries for players. Contrast that with your time as a player. Didn't the players of your day negotiate your own contracts to the best of your ability? Or I've heard in many cases, you just got mailed a contract and were asked to sign it, and you didn't have much input as to what you were going to get the next season.
Well, that's exactly the way it happened. Every spring, they had to tender you a contract before January the 1st. And when they would send you the contract, you either signed it or you didn't. And if you didn't, then that was it.
Yeah.
You could negotiate. They might call you up and say, aren't you going to sign the contract? But you did your own negotiating, and the owners were in such a position that they could just say, well, you know, we finished last with you. We can finish last without you. But I know when the first agent that I came in contact with was he was agent for Phil Negro in Atlanta. His name was Jerry Capstein. And I didn't want to hear about agents. I didn't want to negotiate with him. But he wanted to talk to me about Negro. I wouldn't let him in the office. I went outside and we sat on a concrete slab out there and we talked about his contract. But that was a beginning. The owners nor the general managers wanted to deal with agents. Of course, they'd rather deal with the player. The agent did a good job for him, but the best job of all was Marvin Miller. He's the one that brought the players into a position to speak for themselves and have agents and make a lot of money. And players today are making way too much money, in my opinion, individual players. I think there's a statistic that 20% of the players today are making 80% of the money. That's not right. That's not even for a union, that's not right. They ought to see that it's spread out among the players better. And they don't like older players. They don't care about older players. They could do so much for some of these guys who are down and out and needy, and they don't seem to have any. They're run by lawyers. Paul's a big lawyer. He was dean of law at SMU University. Did you know that?
No.
I'm proud of it.
Eddie, I just wondered if you ever played or were, when you were with the Yankees, was Casey the manager?
Casey was the manager.
Okay, and I'm sure you have at least one Casey story.
Well, yeah.
And if I can follow up with a second one, if I may. How about, did Billy Martin ever manage for you when you were general manager?
No. The answer to the Casey story, you know, Casey was just a very unusual guy. He would talk in that Stingalese of his, and the newspaper men couldn't quite understand what he's talking about. And on the bench, he said a lot of funny things. At the end of the 1955 season, the Yankees had agreed to go to Japan to play some exhibition games, and we did. In fact, I got married the day. There was one off day between the end of the World Series and the time we were leaving for Japan. And I got married on that day. So I was on my honeymoon, and we went to Hawaii, Japan, and then most of the team came home, but some chose to go on around the world instead of coming back through California. And Betty and I, that was our honeymoon. We spent 3 months going around the world, and when we got to Rome, it was like 6 weeks later after we broke up in Japan. And Betty and I are walking down the street in Rome, window shopping, and there was a tie store there that had some attractive ties, and she said, let's go in and look at the ties. And so I said, okay. So we went in, and I heard this voice in the back of the store, and I said, Betty, that's Casey Stengel. She said, I can't be. And with that, here comes Edna and Casey out of that back. And we had no idea in the world where they were anywhere near. And so we, of course, we were happy to see each other. We were staying at the same hotel, and we had dinner that night. And that was a very unusual happening.
Well, first, Mr. Robinson, it's a pleasure, sir, to hear you talk. I was wondering, you've had such an incredible career. You've seen all the really great players from, you know, back in that era and in this era. Who would you consider the three best players? I know it's really hard to say who was the greatest player, but who would you consider the three best players you ever saw play?
Well, you want to include pitchers in there? Well, there's no doubt in my mind that Joe DiMaggio is the best player, best all-around player. And there's no doubt in my mind that Ted Williams was the best hitter. And as far as I'm concerned, there's no doubt in my mind that Allie Reynolds was the best pitcher. But I think that Hal Newhouser, Bob Feller, all those guys were – Newhouser was a tremendous pitcher. They were all good. I'll name you another player, and I think Stan Musial would be my other player.
Eddie, tell him your Allie Reynolds home runs.
Oh, yeah. Allie and I had played briefly together in Cleveland, and he was traded to the Yankees, so we knew each other. But he was with the Yankees now, and I'm with Cleveland, and we're in New York playing. In my rookie year, and I never hit a home run in Yankee Stadium, but I did off Reynolds that day. And I'm so pleased that when I'm running around the bases, I'm thinking, you know, Gary, Ruth, all those guys hit hard. Now I've hit a home run in Yankee Stadium. And I guess I must have been smiling, because when I, next time up, he drilled me, boy, right on the elbow. And they thought it was broken, chipped. After the game, they took me in to see the doctor in the Yankee clubhouse. So I walk in, and there's all the Yankees sitting around. And Reynolds is sitting there. He said, Eddie, don't ever smile when you hit a home run. I said, don't worry, Allie. That really hurt.
Eddie, I have a question about the Ted Williams shift. Was that something that Cleveland put in, or was that put in before that?
No, that was something Cleveland, Boudreau did that. As far as I know, he's the first guy that used a shift.
Did any other teams pick up on it and what? Use it? Did any other teams pick up on it and use
yeah,
it?
Yeah, a couple of teams tried it. Now, Al Lopez, I was a dead pull hitter, and Al Lopez used to do that shift on me and then laugh at me from the dugout when I'd hit a line drive or something and they'd catch it. But they didn't do it. Today, they're much smarter about doing that positioning. I think it's very good.
One last question. Eddie, what was it like being on the Indians when Larry Doby broke in as the first black player in the American League?
Well, it was very similar, of course, to Jackie Robinson with the Dodgers. The sad thing about it is that Robinson got all the acclaim for being the first black. Well, he was the first, but Dobie joined us the same year, but just a few months later. And through the years, Robinson's always gotten the credit, and Dobie, who deserved a lot of credit, didn't get any. As far as how the players felt, well, there was some animosity among the players because they could see that if the blacks were allowed to play in the big league, some of the white guys were going to lose their jobs. So you couldn't very well blame them for having some feelings about it. But as far as his acceptance on the team, he was accepted okay on the Indians team. And I think Pee Wee Reese and some of the guys on the Dodgers, once they accepted Jackie, he was accepted there. There was some, they had more of a problem. They were supposed to have gotten a petition. They didn't want to play with him, those kind of things. But it was tough. And those guys, they couldn't stay in the team hotels. And it was just pretty damn tough. But they lived through it, and I think they're celebrating Martin Luther King. I think Jackie Robinson's right up there with Martin Luther King in furthering advantages of the black race.
Eddie, today we know how hard pitchers pitch because we have radar. Back in your playing days, was there anybody you suppose threw any harder than Bob Feller?
Allie Reynolds. Herb Skoor. Herb Skoor was extremely fast. Bob Turley. I don't think I ever struck out going full count, where ball one, ball two, strike one, strike two. Ball three, and I haven't swung the bat yet. I'm still watching them go by. And so I stepped out of the box, and I said, he's not going to throw this next ball by me. I'm talking about Bob Turley. And he did. I didn't swing the bat. He threw me six pitches, and I was out. The next guy up was Tommy Byrne. They pinched hit. He was a pitcher, but sometimes they used him pinch hit. And I'd be darned if Turley didn't throw him a curveball and he hit a double and cleared the bases. So.
I want to first of all thank the Friends of the Allen Public Library. I want to thank Bob Whiteman with the North Texas Theatrical Organ Society.